You're tuned into the COVID-19 Community Report here on KDRT 95.7 FM, Davis, California. I'm Autumn Labbé-Renault, and today is Tuesday, June 9th. We're sharing local news and resources, focusing on what's impacting Davis and nearby cities in Yolo County during the COVID-19 pandemic, and assorted other activities going on out there. This show airs live Tuesdays at noon and repeats at 5 p.m. and also on Sundays, and you can listen online anytime at kdrt.org. My guests today are Don Saylor, Yolo County Supervisor for District 2, and Don Myers, the Program Coordinator for the Yolo Adult Day Health Center. We'll get to our first interview in just a few minutes, but we start with something different today, because today is the funeral for George Floyd. His death was a catalyst, the pebble that finally launched a landslide. We remember his spirit and commit to work so that his death will not be in vain. Today, this radio station is joining other community radio stations nationwide to commemorate his life and his death. We rise and grieve with a song. Sam Cooke wrote, "A change is gonna come," after being turned away from a whites-only motel in 1963. On this day, Cooke's classic reminds us that even amid senseless loss, our hope cannot be broken. The Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. once said, "Change does not roll in on the wheels of inevitability, but comes through continuous struggle." The fact that this song was written in the early 60s and is still relevant today indicates just how much work we have yet to do. We now join friends across America to share this song on the day of George Floyd's funeral. Thank you for being a part of this community and for supporting this station.
Telling me don't hang around. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. Then I go to my brother. Say, brother, help me, please. But he winds up knocking me back down on my knees. Lord, there have been times that I thought I couldn't last for long. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will.
Rest in power, George Floyd. My first guest today is Yolo County Supervisor Don Saylor. This interview was pre-recorded because, as we're live on the air, Don is taking part in the supervisor's budget hearing he references during this interview. Because it's pre-recorded, it might sound a little bit different. And we'll be back live with Don Myers at the conclusion of this first interview. And I also want to note, next Tuesday we'll have Dr. Marianne Limbos of Yolo Public Health on to talk about the impacts of reopening and the numbers that we're starting to see in California. My guest today is Yolo County Supervisor Don Saylor. I interviewed Don way back in March, and since then, so many things have happened with regard to COVID-19 and the pandemic and the county's response. So I'm glad to welcome him back today. Thanks for being with us.
Well, thanks, Autumn. It's great to be with you again.
Great. So the last week I talked about the county health order that was updated, I believe, as of May 28th. So let's start there and see if there are any additional updates, and maybe let's disambiguate the changes that came with that set of orders.
Well, essentially, the most recent order from Yolo County was to allow our local stay-at-home order to terminate. That leaves the state's shelter-in-place order still in effect. There are a couple of things that Yolo County stuck with. One of them is that's most prominent is to still require face coverings for most settings. The state order simply recommends that. You know, it's a little bit confusing for people because the state orders and the county orders they weren't in conflict, but they would somehow amplify each other. So the thing is, the state is that's kind of the ruling factor. Mm-hmm. Counties can issue orders that are more restrictive than the state, but we don't have the authority to loosen up more than the state has already loosened. So there we get a lot of people would like the Yolo County to open up an activity, say swimming or youth sports. We don't have the ability to do that until the state has released that for us. And you know, right. The state has these four phases of reopening. And the first phase we are already through. The second phase, there were two stages of that second phase. At this point, Yolo County has gone through all of those stages so that things like dine-in service and retail, mm-hmm. In-person retail are all permitted. Today, we're speaking on Friday, June 5th. Mm-hmm. And as we're speaking, the state is releasing an update to their orders that will allow quite a few more activities than have previously been permitted as they move into phase three.
Okay.
Those activities are not going to be allowed until June 12. So one of the challenges that so many people have been facing is that the state would issue an order and then it wouldn't be effective until the county had followed up and released this additional guidance that we might want to implement. And this time the state has given us a few days to sort out what they're doing and determine how it applies to our local circumstance. So this release that's coming out now will free up a number of different activities and issue some guidelines for schools, day camp, schools in the fall, day camps, revised child care, some pro sports without audiences, and some hotels. Hotels have been open, but only for essential business, mm-hmm. such as medical personnel who've had to move from one location to another, or people who are working in an essential business category called essential. Right. So there'll be quite a bit more activities that'll be opened up with this order that's coming out on June 5th. It won't be effective till June 12th. So there's going to be some built-in confusion. Because some of the news releases will say the state issues new order, and people will believe that that's something that they can move to
sure.
right away.
So what we want people to hear is that there's a process and it takes a little bit of time. And every week on the show, I keep driving people back to the YoloCounty.org website and with the roadmap to recovery and the resources that are right there in the spotlight on the front page. So to be consistent with what my messaging has been, please do that. If you have a question, it's really the county that is driving those decisions and keeping us informed here in Yolo County. I'm aware that the decision to reopen, it's a tough one for everyone. We're dealing with it as an organization at Davis Media Access, but the county had to deal with it, you know, writ large. And I'm aware that it wasn't an easy decision. There wasn't, consensus among all of you as to how to go about that. One of my concerns moving forward is that we start to see numbers and things that don't keep us where we need to be. So my question is, how will the Board of Supervisors and how will the county address that if the numbers start spiking again?
Well, thanks for referring to that county website, because one of the pages there is a couple of dashboards. Mm-hmm. One of the dashboards is on the data, like number of cases. We have about 216 cases and 24 deaths have taken place so far in Yolo County. So you can see where those cases are by geography. But another part of the dashboard is what's going on in senior nursing facilities. Mm-hmm. So there's a dashboard category for that, and that's primarily focused on the one facility in Woodland, Stolwood, that has had 17 of those 24 deaths have taken place among residents of that facility. But the third element on the dashboard that I think is right on point to your question, Autumn, is one that talks is based on what's called attestation criteria, and these are facts that we are metrics that we're following to determine if for some reason we have an uptick in the cases, or our containment strategies are faltering, or we've got no insufficient capacity in the hospitals or for testing. And so those at this point, you can take a look at those and see. It's very hard to, I would think it would be very difficult to close activities that have been opened. Mm-hmm. For a lot of reasons. One is human beings are reluctant to be sort of whipsawed around, and businesses, if they've invested in reopening, that means they've hired people back, they've acquired inventory, they've made investments in their new operation. So we want to as best as we can do it right the first time. Yeah, but we do have the authority and capacity to regroup. I'll note that Sonoma County, just down the road, over the past few weeks, did open up quite a few activities, had a dramatic uptick in confirmed COVID cases, and had to close, had to kind of step back, take a pause, and start over again. So that's a very unfortunate circumstance. The reason we're in kind of a good position here is Yolo County was one of the early counties for closing some activities down, and it wasn't a hard decision. That was one that we had great advice from Ron Chapman, our health officer, to begin that process a little bit earlier than much of the state and most of the country. And we had very good adherence. People really cooperated with that for the most part, and we kept the case counts down very low. Our case counts at 216 are very low for a population of 222,000 people. So we've done a good job. And because of that, we were able to move forward. Right around Memorial Day weekend, there was a few days there where we weren't quite ready. We didn't feel like we were in a position as a county, not just the county government, but our communities, to open up. And we're now at a point where, in this airs on June 9, we'll be about will be close to 2 weeks after that Memorial Day weekend. There was quite a bit of gatherings and community. There was people were going out on the American River down to the beach here and there, or going to, they were just kind of getting out and doing a lot of socializing. Yolo County was not a part of that. Well, some of our residents did go to some of those events. It's going to be, I'm concerned that after these 2 weeks have passed, we're going to see some of our neighboring counties with some case counts going back up again. So we didn't do that, and we'll see how it unfolds. Now, I'd like to say that just because some of these activities are opening up doesn't mean that it's a good idea. Mm-hmm. So we've seen some businesses have already come out. I think Ketmo Ray and Student Works come to mind. They've been made announcements that they're not comfortable reopening to their their previous kinds of business, and that's been, I think that's tough for them, but they made that decision. Individuals can choose whether to go someplace, and if they're uncomfortable when they get there, if they see that they're uncomfortable with the practices or lack of face coverings among other customers or anything like that, mm-hmm. Well, they can leave. Just like when you go for a walk and you realize that it's a little too crowded in that location, your best bet is to turn around. Mm-hmm. If you're in a vulnerable population, or over 65 or have underlying health issues, just because you can now go shopping, you don't have to. You should be mindful of your own safety.
And Don, the next few weeks will be pretty instructive, not only for the Memorial Day weekend you mentioned, but just the fact that restaurants are now open, people are gathering, and people are also encountering each other in larger numbers via protest in the area around Black Lives Matter. And so all of that is going to have an impact. We have just a couple minutes left, so I want to be sure we get to hone in on what's coming before the Board of Supervisors next. You've been, obviously, this is far from your only focus, although it's taken a lot of your bandwidth in the last couple of months. But what else can we look forward to?
Well, the reason that we're recording this on Friday, June 5th, is that June 9th is one of our annual budget hearings. And so we'll be looking at a budget of $493 million in all funds. And that's going to, we're facing a year where, as we start out, there's a lot of uncertainty. We've spent almost $5 million on COVID-related activities in these last couple of months housing homeless people, providing food to people at their homes, just a lot of procurement of PPEs, a lot of things that we've spent funds for. So we think some of it'll be replaced or reimbursed from FEMA or the CARES Act through the state government, but we'll see. And we see a downturn in revenue of about $8 million. So we're looking at a budget hole just at this point of about $13 million for the county. So that'll be a big part of what we do. And we'll look at phase out of the shelter in hotels for about 270 homeless people that we've been able to find a place for. We'll be looking at transitioning out and bringing the county workforce back to work, mm-hmm. helping people with additional guidances for safe reopening of all these things. And we're doing all this at a time when our communities and the people in Yolo County are watching very, very carefully the nationwide response to the terrible killing of a human being in Minneapolis by a police department that should have been protecting him. And so we're, I know that today, June 9th, is the memorial service for George Floyd. And my heart goes out to his family and to everyone who has been touched so deeply. And that's all of us. And so we have to redouble all of our efforts to make sure this stops.
Okay. Well, I want to thank you once again for joining us here. You do a great job of helping keep us updated, and people can reach you via that same webpage we talked about earlier. All the county supervisors can be reached there, yolocounty.org. My thanks to you, Don Saylor.
Thank you so much, Autumn, for doing this series.
Okay, thanks again to Don Saylor for doing that interview with me earlier in the week. I am about to welcome here Don Myers, who is the program coordinator for the Yolo Adult Day Health Center. Don, are you with us?
Yes, I am.
Thank you.
Good afternoon.
Good to hear your voice. So let's start by telling us about what your program does, and then we'll talk about how it's been impacted lately.
Okay, great. Yolo Adult Day Health Center is a program that's been part of our community since 1984, built by volunteers and Yolo County Health Department. And our mission is to target frail adults in the community who are struggling to be safe at home. And so we have folks that have multiple medical conditions, functional challenges with walking and maybe using their arms, and then cognitively struggling as well. So for folks that have those challenges, often the emergency room, hospital, and even skilled nursing tends to be frequented. And so what we do is basically take a nursing home model, provide all the nursing, all of the rehabilitation, social work, activities, programs that you would see in a nursing home, only we do it here at the center, and we send vehicles out every morning to bring people from all around Yolo County to come to the center and receive the services here in a congregate setting. And the beauty of our program is you get all these wonderful services that really help maintain your safety and improve the quality of your life in an while you're congregating, while you're with other people, making friends, being able to explore areas that you might be interested in, and just having the ability to be in a social setting, which is really what I always call the secret sauce of our program.
Now, I imagine that the program also provides an important element of respite care for some folks as well.
Absolutely. Of our 90 participants in our program, probably about half are really dependent on their caregivers, and often they're working full-time still, or they're an elderly spouse themselves and have a lot of medical issues, and so by having that respite, it makes all the difference in their ability to be at home. And then there's a large portion of our population who are very low income and live alone and and have not such a robust support system, and that's where we come in and we really fill in all those gaps for that person.
Right. And am I correct? Until a few years ago, your organization was a private nonprofit, and then you became part of Dignity Health, correct?
We have always had the license with Yolo County.
Okay.
We're one of the few centers of the 250 in the state that have that. And then the county has always worked with a nonprofit to provide the service. So up until 1998, it was Escaton. And then in 1998, Dignity Health became that partner with the county. And that's the way it's been for the last 20 years.
Gotcha. Okay. So your work happens in a congregate setting, as you've said. So what has happened during the pandemic? Has it been shut down?
It's been such a dynamic experience. So on March 16th, when Governor Newsom said that we can no longer congregate with people, group sizes over 10, we immediately knew we needed to basically flip our model, because it was clear that we are serving the highest risk, the portion of our population that we are all most concerned about, the elderly, multiple chronic health conditions. So we flipped our model. So we spent the first week of starting March 16th, and home health nurses came over and trained us how to go into people's homes safely, what are all the protocols. And so we have been in daily contact with all of our participants since we've flipped, and are operating as what we call temporary alternative services. The state's been very supportive in helping us centers transition. And to date, we have had no COVID cases, and all of the participants that are sheltering in place have, we ensure they have their medications. Physical therapy goes out and provides support to make sure they're still able to transfer. We send activity packs out so that there's some fun involved. We deliver lunches, and then we're on the phone a lot.
Wow, that's phenomenal, Dawn. I know a lot of nonprofits have had to retool to offer services, but that's over and above.
Well, thank you. Well, you know, we just know that, and we all see the statistics of what is happening in the nursing homes. And so, you know, over 40% of our deaths in our state have been nursing home related. So it's just been such an important focus for us to make sure we keep people as safe as possible. And so far, so good.
Mm. So we're down to our last couple of minutes. I want to talk about what comes next for you with reopening or funding or how the state supported you. What's going to change in the next month or two?
Our biggest challenge is the unfortunate with the $54 billion deficit for California state. The budget proposal that came out in May actually had adult day health care eliminated, and that was devastating to imagine. We have a huge advocacy effort that has taken place, and to date we're in the place where the Senate has developed an alternative budget to prevent the elimination of adult day health care, along with the multi-purpose senior services program and our in-home support services program. And the Assembly is very clearly moving in the direction of adopting the Senate budget, which means that we're safe as long as the governor accepts this proposal. Mm-hmm. The governor will see this budget on Monday the 15th, okay. And he has the ability to adjust. We're hoping that if all goes well, the budget will not contain elimination of adult day health care. So really the push right now for us in terms of our statewide advocacy for the 37,000 participants that depend on adult day health care is to really send our messaging to the governor to not eliminate adult day health care.
Okay, and an email and website for people who might want to get more info or advocate on behalf of that.
The best way to advocate is to literally just Google contact the governor. There's a website that it will take you to, and you enter in your information, and you can voice your opinion on the elimination of adult day health care. There's also a great opportunity to learn more on our website, our California Association of Adult Day Services website, CADS.org. It's a big I didn't want to try and have the listeners, so I thought maybe best just to call me. I would be more than happy to answer any questions that people have about adult day health care, about where we're at in our advocacy, and as we're slowly planning our soft opening. And a good number for me is Dawn Myers, and the number is 530-666-8828. So by calling 666-8828 and ask for me, I can send you a lot of other email addresses.